Our next speaker will be David Bishop, and his talk from Australia, and his talk will be Can We Optimise the Exercise Training Prescription to Maximise Improvements in Mitochondria Function and Content?
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you. Won't be the last time I'm upstaged by my son, I'm sure. Okay. So, first of all, thanks to Brendan for a really excellent overview showing that exercise is a powerful stimulus to increase mitochondrial biogenesis. What I want to talk about today is that we know in general exercise is powerful, but is there a specific exercise stimulus to promote improvements in mitochondria? And does the nature of the exercise stimulus promote different adaptations? Just to begin, what I'd like to do is just start with a couple of definitions, because if you go through the literature, you'll often see different terms used interchangeably, especially with respect to high-intensity exercise. So I'll be talking about moderate intensity continuous training, so continuous aerobic type exercise between about 50 and 80% of heart rate max, high-intensity interval training, which will be intervals of around about 80 to 100% VO2 max, interspersed by short recovery periods, and sprint interval training as well, whether, again, intervals, anything above 100% of VO2 max, but typically all-out sprints are used. And there's also, there's lots of indirect ways to look at mitochondria, but specifically most of the research that I'll be mentioning today will be using the muscle biopsy technique and looking at changes in content and function using the muscle tissue. If we look in the mitochondria, so obviously the mitochondria are a double membraned organelle and are responsible for producing most of the ATP. As Brendan highlighted, there's many ways that the mitochondria can adapt, but I'm going to broadly and maybe simplistically classify it into three main ways. So the first way is that mitochondria can increase their content. So I've illustrated this as an increase in the number of mitochondria, but again, as Brendan highlighted, it's probably more correct to say there's an increase in the volume of the mitochondria or an increase in the volume of the mitochondrial reticulum. We can also have little change in the content, but an improvement in the function of the mitochondria. So same amount of mitochondria, but better able to produce ATP. Or we can have a combination of the two. When throughout the talk and when we're measuring function, we talk about, we'll do it with mitochondrial respiration. If we see this sort of adaptation, I'll be talking about mass-specific respiration. So what that means is that there's an increase in the respiration of the total mitochondria. In this sort of, in this instance here, I'll be talking about mitochondrial-specific respiration. So in that case, same amount of mitochondria, but the mitochondria that is there is better able to produce ATP. So if we look into the mitochondria and what happens with training, the classic study that most people refer to is this study by Holossi. So back in 1967. So this was in mice, and what they showed was that exercising mice, there was a large increase in mitochondrial protein. Typically, the gold standard technique to measure changes in mitochondrial content is the electron microscopy. And so with that, you can, as I said, measure changes in mitochondrial volume. So quite a time-consuming, and also you need to be quite skilled to do this, and we're doing a little bit of this in our lab, but there has been some studies, and this one's from Carsten Lundby, showing that exercise training can increase mitochondrial volume density. Most studies, however, as I said, don't have access to this technique, so typically indirect measures are used. And in this case, a nice study by Philip Larson showing that mitochondrial content on the x-axis as measured by electron microscopy, was quite strongly correlated with citrate synthase. So a lot of studies will use citrate synthase as a biomarker for mitochondrial content, and you'll see in most of the studies that I'll present in the upcoming slides relate to citrate synthase. And the main reason is that there's a lot of studies there, and that allows us to pool the results and I think draw stronger conclusions. So we've recently looked at this idea of, if we have a look at all of the studies out there, and I can't remember, there's 30 or 40 studies in this review that's now online, and we tried to have a look, is there a relationship between training volume and training intensity and changes in mitochondrial content as assessed by citrate synthase? And if you look at the graph here on the left, you can see that when we plot training intensity as a percent of VO2 peak, and this is change in citrate synthase activity on the y-axis, there's basically a flat line. So we don't see any relationship between training intensity and percent VO2 peak. But if we look at training volume, and you could think of this where you actually multiplied intensity by volume, but you can think of this as minutes of exercise. And you can see here that we see quite a strong correlation, R value of 0.6, between training volume and change in our marker of mitochondrial content. So it suggests that the greater the training volume, the greater the changes in mitochondrial content. And you can see there is some, there's obviously some variability there, but I think considering the number of studies and the variability in the citrate synthase assay, it seems to be quite a strong relationship. Obviously, correlation doesn't imply causation. So we tried to also do an interventional study. And what we did here is we had participants come in and do what we've called normal training. So they did 3 days per week for 4 weeks. And then we had them come in and do intensive training. So this was interval training, 2 times a day, 7 days a week for 3 weeks. So you can see on this left graph here, a massive increase in the training volume. And we had biopsies here, here, and here, where we measured citrate synthase activity. And those results are on the right. So what you can see here is before the normal training, after the normal training, we didn't see any significant change in citrate synthase activity, our marker of mitochondrial content. But post the intensive training phase, you can see we've seen a large and significant increase in our marker of mitochondrial content. So suggesting that training volume may play an important role. And what I also found interesting, if we go back to this graph I showed you previously, this red dot here is the study that I just showed you. So it fits, I think quite nicely on this particular relationship. We want to also, we're interested in why, and this is what we've got some studies going on at the moment, looking at trying to explain some mechanisms as to why this might be the case. And one of the hypotheses we're pursuing is that high volume may be promoting mitochondrial fusion and leading to an increase in this mitochondrial volume. And so this study, by Carsten, has shown that with continuous training, you get a significant increase in MFN. And another study by Cesare in my lab, when we compared 4 weeks of moderate intensity continuous training, high intensity interval training, and sprint interval training, it wasn't significant, but we did see a trend for greater improvements in MFN2 with moderate intensity continuous training. So we're doing some follow-up studies on this and trying to see whether, in fact, continuous training is a stronger stimulus for promoting mitochondrial fusion and increases in mitochondrial volume. If we go to, I guess, the other end of the training intensity continuum there, we've also looked at what I referred to earlier as mitochondrial specific respiration. So what we do there is we look at the changes in mass specific respiration in our permeabilized fibers, and we divide the changes in respiration by our marker of mitochondrial content. So the idea is to get an idea on the function of individual mitochondria, if I can refer it to that way. And when we look at this, we see that we don't see any changes in mitochondrial specific respiration with either the continuous training, the high intensity interval training, but we see a large and significant increase only with the sprint interval training. And again, we've got an ongoing study looking at this at the moment, but we see some evidence, and our hypothesis is that maybe this very high sprint interval training is a powerful stimulus to promote mitophagy and the splitting of mitochondria into smaller mitochondria. And so there's some evidence that if the mitochondrial reticulum becomes too long, it becomes less efficient. And what we think is that potentially sprint interval training is a powerful stimulus to promote mitophagy and promote the replacement of older, less functional mitochondria with newer, better functioning mitochondria. And as I said, hopefully next year we'll have some data to present on that particular hypothesis. We also want to follow up some really nice work from Niels Altenblad's lab. This is cross-sectional data, but what he showed was that when you compared sedentary and trained, that there was an increase in the mitochondrial cristae density. So it had been thought that mitochondrial cristae density wasn't a plastic characteristic of mitochondria and was stable, but his research seems to indicate that highly trained people have a more densely packed mitochondria. So that may also be a potential mechanism which is helping to explain why training can improve mitochondrial function. And again, this is a cross-sectional study, so at the moment we're performing a training study to see if this is also a characteristic of the mitochondria that changes dynamically. If we then go into the middle, and again, this is from our recent review paper, which is online, it seems that high-intensity interval training at around about somewhere between 90 and 100% of VO2 max is a powerful stimulus to increase mass-specific mitochondrial respiration. And so and we think that this is training volume over here, and these are the particular studies and the training intensity. And what we think there is happening is that maybe this high intensity training, you're getting a little bit of the best of both worlds, so to speak. So you're getting both, the volume is high enough to get an increase in mitochondrial volume, and potentially the intensity is also high enough to get an increase in mitochondrial function. And when you put those two things together, then you're going to get an increase in the mass-specific respiration. So that's the respiration per gram of tissue. It's also been suggested that one of the reasons that high-intensity training is able to improve mass-specific respiration is by an increase in these mitochondrial supercomplexes. So I think everyone's aware we've got the complexes 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 of the electron transport chain. But although they're nearly always sort of drawn as these independent complexes, they can also cluster and form what are called these supercomplexes. Specifically, 1, 3, and 4 can come together. And the idea is that by coming together, instead of having this distance to transfer electrons, what you're doing, you're having the complexes more closely in proximity. Maybe that reduces the distance of the electron transfer and improves the efficiency of mitochondrial respiration. And this particular study showed, so I use the blue native technique, and to anyone who's used SDS page, it's a slightly different technique. So instead of using denaturing and separating out all the proteins, you actually keep the protein complexes together as they travel through the membrane, through the gel. And this particular study showed that in elderly with high intensity training, they saw a significant increase in the supercomplexes, and suggested that may be one mechanism that helps to explain why high intensity training is able to improve the mitochondrial function. So we've recently looked at this as well, and what we saw is similar results. So these are the actual gels there, and the super complexes are labelled. And we saw that with training, you can see here the different super complexes, there was a significant increase in the super complexes, just as Greggio found. But if you look here, this is the data that I showed you previously, presented a slightly different way, but we don't see any significant change in the mitochondrial specific respiration, so the function of the individual mitochondria. So at least in our hands, and also in younger participants this case, the increase in the super complexes seems to parallel the increase in mitochondrial volume, but it doesn't seem to be explaining any changes in the mitochondrial specific respiration. Most of the studies to date, and certainly the studies in our lab, have also tend to look at comparing distinct types of training. So continuous training compared with interval training, compared with sprint interval training. And so I think in the future, what we need to start looking at is also how do we combine these different types of training together. And this is, there's lots of great studies by Hickson, and this is an interesting one. So in this study here, they did these 10 weeks of training, and they had quite a high volume of training that combined continuous training and high intensity interval training. And it's probably, still, this is only changes in VO2 max, but it's still one of the studies that's shown probably some of the greatest changes in VO2 max with training, with this type of combined training. So it'd be interesting, I think, in future research to start looking at how do we combine the different types of training to optimise changes in mitochondria. And this is just some preliminary data, or some unpublished data, from a study with our collaborators in Brazil. And what we had here was changes in mitochondrial mass-specific respiration when we trained once a day. And so that was alternating continuous and high-intensity interval training, or when we trained twice a day. So every second day we had continuous and interval training together. And it was only 3 weeks and it wasn't significant, but we're seeing what looks like a trend for greater improvements in mitochondrial function when we combine these two types of training together. So as I said, I think this will be an important area for future research. And what's also interesting, I think, is at the moment, most of our work is on skeletal muscle, and most of the stuff we've seen today has been on skeletal muscle. But this is, again, some unpublished study data from our lab, and this is in rodents. But we looked at changes in mitochondrial function in the kidneys following exercise training. And it was one of those things we kind of probably did out of curiosity more than anything else. But what was really interesting, and these are the different markers of mitochondrial function, but after training, we saw a significant increase in mitochondrial function of the kidney. So the rats running on the treadmill also improved their mitochondrial function in the kidney. So I think this is also a really interesting area for research, and there's a lot of interest at the moment in exokines and myokines released from muscles. And we don't know the mechanisms, but it seems, at least from this data, that exercising our skeletal muscles can also have benefits on mitochondrial function in other tissues. And this probably contributes to some of the health benefits of exercise. I also want to show this data. One of the great things about mitochondria is that they're really plastic. So it means that short amounts of training, you can get big increases in mitochondrial content, mitochondrial function. But the flip side of that plasticity is that once you stop exercising, they also very quickly return back to where they were before. So this is a study I showed you before, presented slightly differently. When we did the intensive training, so this was two times a day, 7 days a week for 3 weeks. I think we had about a 35-40% improvement in mitochondrial function. We then gave them 2 weeks of like a taper or reduced training, so 5 sessions in 2 weeks, and basically they lost all of those gains in mitochondrial function. So, if you're one of the participants in this study, you're going to be feeling fairly ripped off You know, you've come in and trained 2 days, twice a day, 7 days a week for 3 weeks, got good changes, and after 2 weeks you'd almost lost all of those gains. So I think the public health message of this is the importance of habitual training and not just these bursts of training. If we look into the nucleus, we also want to try and have a look at some of the mechanisms that might explain some of these differences. And so these are nuclear changes in PGC1 alpha, and we've compared moderate intensity continuous training and sprint interval training. If you recall previously, we showed that sprint interval training was more powerful for improving mitochondrial specific respiration. And sprint interval training, and this is, so we've taken muscle biopsies pre plus 0 hours and 3 hours after exercise, is also a more powerful stimulus for increasing the amount of PGC1 alpha in the nucleus. So this may be contributing why sprint interval training is such a powerful stimulus for improving mitochondrial function. We've also looked at the phosphorylation of P53, which has also been implicated in mitochondrial biogenesis, again in the nucleus. So P53, sorry about this, but if it can get phosphorylated by AMPK and also P38, and that increases the stability of P53 in the nucleus. And so we've looked at both of those, and again, sprint interval training causes a greater increase in phospho P38 in the nucleus and potentially contributing to the stability and the increase in phospho P53 in the nucleus. So I guess the point of this is that there seems to be some mechanistic explanations for why sprint interval training seems to be a better stimulus for increasing mitochondrial function. We've also got some, again from Brazil, some unpublished data here, and I'll just run you through here. So what we looked at here, and this is, remember earlier I showed you some of our research from Brazil showing that maybe training twice per day could potentially be a powerful stimulus for improving mitochondrial function. And so what we've got here in the grey is a control group who just did high intensity interval training in the afternoon. We had another group that did once daily training. So they did glycogen depleting exercise in the evening, and then came back the next afternoon and did the high intensity interval training. And then we had a twice a day group that did the continuous glycogen depleting exercise in the morning and then the high intensity interval exercise in the afternoon. And so what you can see just here, and for a range of different factors, so PGC1 alpha, mRNA, PPAR alpha and PPAR beta delta, that when we did exercise twice in a day, even though it was exactly the same, we're seeing a greater increase in the mRNA of these transcription factors. And again, if we look inside the nucleus, what was interesting is we saw a greater increase in nuclear TFAB and a greater increase in nuclear NFAT in the nucleus when we did this exercise twice in the 1 day. And so when we do contractile activity, there's a release of calcium which activates calcineurin, and that can dephosphorylate both TFAB and NFAT and allow them to move into the nucleus where they can perform their transcriptional roles. And so again, we want to explore this, but potentially how we combine exercise, and in this case by doing exercise twice in a day, we think that there may be greater activity of calcineurin, and potentially that's contributing to greater transcriptional activity, and that may ultimately lead to greater mitochondrial biogenesis. Thanks. And also want to point out, this classic study by Chris Perry in Canada, is that when we do exercise, so we get in this case PGC1 alpha, so it indicates an activation of mitochondrial biogenesis, but subsequent exercise at the same intensity seems to be dampening this effect. And I guess that kind of relates to the need to progressively overload. And we've got some unpublished data showing a similar thing for nuclear PGC1 alpha, which I think is interesting. So if you look in white, when we did, before they did the intensive phase, they do the exercise, in this case, high intensity interval training, and we see a significant increase in PGC1 alpha in the nucleus. But when we got the participants back after they'd done their 3 weeks of training and did exactly the same exercise, so at the same, in this case, absolute intensity, that signal was completely lost. So again, I think that supports and follows up on some of Chris's data, showing the need that why we need to alter the exercise stimulus and progressively overload to be able to maintain the exercise, the effects of the exercise and the effects on mitochondrial biogenesis. So just to finish and a quick summary. So we think that when we do training, moderate intensity training probably has a more powerful improvement in mitochondrial volume. And interestingly, that may quite often doesn't lead to an increase in mitochondrial specific respiration, because you're having the same volume, but is for the greater volume, there's a proportional increase in the ability to produce ATP. And some studies will also show a decrease in mitochondrial specific respiration, but the ability to produce ATP per gram of tissue should increase with an increase in volume. High intensity interval training seems to be a little bit in between, so it seems to be able to increase mitochondrial volume and potentially may also increase mitochondrial specific respiration, whereas at least in our lab and when we looked at the collective data, sprint interval training doesn't seem to be a strong stimulus to increase mitochondrial content, but it does increase mitochondrial specific respiration. A highlight here, so our studies also suggest this use it or lose it. So if you don't continue to train, you can very quickly lose the gains that you get with training. And progressive overload seems to be important to maintain the stimulus and to have continued improvements in the mitochondria. And nutrition is probably also important, but that'll be Andy will talk about some of that in his next talk. So how can we also manipulate nutrition to optimise mitochondrial adaptations. So with that, we sort of hope that, you know, with this information, we can better prescribe exercise as medicine to improve health, and hopefully it also has implications for how we can prescribe training to improve athlete performance. Thank you.